example there, or as previously my teammates said in earlier speeches, that's an example of linking a prepared speech to a live, real-time contribution that's actually based on something that the speakers have heard in the debate as it's unfolding. So keep note of that. That's something to shoot for as you're doing your own debates in your classrooms.
All right, now we get to hear from the question panel once again, asking questions of the affirmative debaters.
So the affirmative side stated that everything contains bias, that nothing doesn't, and that it essentially runs through everything. If bias is present in both social media and mass media, do social media and mass media outlets have responsibility to promote factual information?
Yes, they should provide factual information, but with factual information comes bias. Everything has bias in it, like I previously stated, and we can't avoid it. It is up to the individual to pick out the particulars from the news presented to them and make a decision on their own.
Going off of that, what exactly then is improving democratic decision making? Is it social and mass media, or is it the ability to be a critical thinking public to sort through the bias which you acknowledge?
I think that the quality of democratic decision making is simply the public being more informed, because if we are a democracy, then that means we are representative of every individual that has an opinion. So, yes.
A follow-up to that, is there a difference between being a more informed public and a more knowledgeable one?
We can always use a more informed public, but when it comes to media, people have to choose for themselves what they believe in. And when it comes to knowledge, knowledge can be found anywhere, but it can be found anywhere, but the individual must choose.
And I feel like an informed public is a knowledgeable public.
I believe it is still within the relevance of the debate to talk about what if someone is ignorant of methods of researching and they simply don't know how to think critically about what they're reading online. And even though they have all this information coming to them, are they simply out of luck because they can't separate clickbait from real news, or is there some method that they can use or some source of education that could help them?
Can you restate your question? Yeah. Are you asking?
If someone can't separate clickbait, as someone in the audience eloquently put it, from real news, are they out of luck? Can they not be, are they not helped by social and mass media? Does social and mass media improve the quality of democratic decision making only for those who can think critically?
I don't believe so, because it makes all sorts of information readily available to everybody, and it's up to the person to research a topic that is shown to them by way of social and mass media. And it's still up to the person whether to believe what they believe and what they're reading.
You had mentioned that media users are often bombarded by so much information. Do you believe that this overwhelming amount of information can often lead to distractions from the situations at hand?
Yes, that's always a danger. However, if it were personally me, I would be frustrated by everything, and it would make me want to get to the bottom of the topic that's at hand. So I feel like anybody who is motivated to research the political topics or any topic at hand will be able to find out what they truly believe.
You mentioned how social and mass media can get more people involved in marches for a cause. However, there are things like the Arab Spring that was powered by social media, and Tunisia is the only nation out of a dozen that still has a democratically elected leader. How do you explain the fact that nowadays marches and petitions and things, even with so much more involvement than they had in the 70s perhaps, they don't get the same things done politically?
Well, I do believe that protests and marches can get things done politically. Protests and marches are a way for people to express how they feel and express what they believe. People believe that protests, it stops there, like with the Women's March, it stops there, but people will always have to protest. They will always have something to say. So I feel like it does lead to more things, because it'll always be here. Everybody has an opinion, and they deserve to share their opinion.
if I may clarify, I think not just the march clearly shows the involvement. However, if the people involved in the march are not taking the next step to either write to their locally elected official or getting the policies changed by voting, is it really improvement, or are they just simply showing their face at a rally to say they're on a side of a topic or a side of an opinion?
Yes, I do think that they are involved. Everybody has to start somewhere, whether it is just marching, and it's step by step. Whether they're just marching or even going to an official, they are still making a difference by promoting the cause.
Thank you very much, panelists. Quick comment here is just that it seems like in response to this series of questions from the panelists, the affirmative team is staking out what really could be a kind of a radical position, because if I heard them correctly, they're saying it's almost all the citizens' responsibility. That yes, the internet, in terms of social and mass media, it's going to put out a lot of stuff. Some of it might be questionable, but the affirmative team has confidence in the ability of citizens to figure out what they should pay attention to, what they should discount, what they should highlight. They could have said, there could have been a different strategy that they would have taken, which would have said, well, there needs to be some regulation of the internet. We need to have some gatekeepers to prevent some of this stuff from actually reaching the citizenry. That's not the strategy that the affirmative is taking. They're taking the very, very democratic high road and saying, we're going to put all this stuff out here and have confidence that citizens can sort it out. That does set up some opportunities for the negative, as well as possibly for the rebuttalists, the affirmative rebuttalists, an opportunity to come back to this theme and weave it back into the resolution. Eric?
All right, thank you. We get to hear again from the negative team now, extending the arguments from the first speeches. Our second general negative speaker will be Emily Richard.
Extra, extra, read all about it. This is a sing-song slogan that is associated with the quintessential newspaper boy selling the latest news on the street corners of the most populated cities. But are the stories that he peddles factual, proven, real, or are they merely concoction of biased liberal and conservative opinions? Unfortunately, stories of today fall short of most of those criteria. Therefore, social and mass media absolutely does not improve the citizens' democratic decision-making process. We should all see the greedy media as the industry it is. We must see through the embellished stories that are written by journalists. Journalists exploit their duty to deliver news for their own personal paycheck gain at the expense of the American citizens' knowledge base. This is not a new concept, and in fact was quite common in the newspaper stories that were published leading up to the Spanish and American War. Yellow journalism was perfected by Joseph Pulitzer and William Randolph Hearst. They sensationalized stories, exhausted scandals, and captured the public with attention-grabbing headlines, all for their own paper's gain. Alarmingly, the practice is emerging again in the 21st century. 24-hour news is where this latest strand of yellow journalism has manifested. Televised news often covers overblown stories that have more entertainment appeal than factual basis. In the latest presidential election of 2016, which my colleague will detail further later, candidates were scrutinized on everything from what color they wore to what they said decades ago. In the age of fake news and alternative facts, the over 15 types of media bias are being exposed. After all, the industry does employ more liberals than conservatives. And as Robert Samuelson from the Washington Post notes, conservatives often say illegal aliens when liberals refer to undocumented workers. Also, what liberals refer to as the estate tax, conservatives call the death tax. These slight tweaks in the text skew the meaning and impact of the reader. Therefore, it is vital to peel back the curtain of slant created by the journalists and news networks and gaze at how competition for money between the news outlets causes the demand for interesting quasi-factual stories that sell papers or make individuals tune in. Overall, the slant in social and mass media fogs the true information and therefore does not affect the decision of the citizen. Televised news and newspapers manipulate the citizens' views on issues through embellishing and running stories that provide more entertainment rather than facts that allow the citizens to educate themselves on political issues and candidates. Citizens are left to defend themselves and draw on their own values and beliefs when they stand at the ballot box. So, go read all about it. In newspapers, on television, you surely get extra, extra bias and glitterized generalities in the manufactured news stories of day. Thank you.
There is one more middle speech, and there is, we made an unfortunate error on the program. And so we listed Carolyn twice by accident. The next speaker is actually going to be TJ Pascucci for the making the second specific negative case.
So last year, the United States was downgraded by the EUI from a full democracy to a flawed democracy for the first time in American history. A flawed democracy, characterized by underdeveloped political atmosphere and voter apathy, is not the democratic basis this nation was founded upon. Mass and social media have played such a crucial role in this downgrade and have significantly hindered our most important democratic decisions. More specifically, they have impeded our most recent presidential election in two key ways: how the candidates were shown and what was presented about the candidates. So let's start with how the candidates were shown. The first thing to notice is the allocation of coverage for each candidate is highly skewed. Trump received more than 2.5 times the coverage that Hillary did, and almost double the coverage of every other candidate combined. And this phenomenon is largely due to the fact that mass and social media are businesses, and they're able to push their own agenda in order to produce ratings, in order to produce profits. But you also have to consider the political and non-political bias in mass and social media. Going back to the 2012 campaign, 46% of Obama's coverage was on Fox News was negative, while only 6% was positive. Whereas on MSNBC, 71% of Romney's coverage was negative versus the 3% that was actually positive. And although the affirmative believes that this bias is okay, my colleagues and I see this bias as a hindrance to democratic decision-making. There's also the example of Dana Milbank, a Washington Post columnist, who asked the DNC for research for a negative Trump column, and he wrote in April, called The 10 Plagues of Trump. This article was highly biased towards Trump, and at one point almost cost him the entire presidential race. Now let's talk about what was shown about the candidates, starting with the fact that inaccurate information is ubiquitous in mass and social media. According to PolitiFact.com, after the fact-checking of news channels in 2014, 45% of the claims from NBC and MSNBC have been rated mostly false, false, or pants on fire false. And at Fox News, that number was 58%. At CNN, that number was 22%. So with most individuals relying solely on this information alone, voters come into the booth uninformed and unaware and ignorant of the true facts around them. And let's talk one more time about that mass and social media-derived phenomenon of fake news. Take, for example, Hillary's email scandal. Now, do remember, it's never been definitively proven that this scandal is reality. However, mass and social media have helped it become a publicly perceived truth, basically killing any chance Clinton had at winning our latest presidential election. Hillary Clinton needed 53,650 votes to become our 45th president. That's about 2/10,000 of the United States population. And after all you've heard today, I firmly negate the resolution, for mass and social media have not only destroyed the chances of political hopefuls everywhere, but it has obliterated the democratic foundation our country was based upon. Thank you.
So we'll now hear from the questioner panel one last time. They have 4 minutes to ask probing questions, this time of the negative team.
Democracy is certainly not a new institution, so that requires a bit of a forward first. In the election of 1800, the United States saw its first mudslinging election. In fact, presidential hopeful John Adams said that his opponent, Thomas Jefferson, was dead. Spoiler alert, Thomas Jefferson was not actually dead. With that in mind, can it be argued that social and mass media provide a wider outlook and expand the horizons on information, but it does not distort this information, as bias has always had its place in democracy?
I mean, mass and social media are going to definitely help that bias. If we're going to look at the ability of every citizen of the United States to have this platform in order to produce whatever they believe without that ability to fact check, although it might give a wider range for people to read this information and see it, it doesn't necessarily help the democratic decision making of that. And at the same time, it kind of hurts that, if you will.
I question the affirmative, and I would like to ask the negative now. Is there a difference between being an informed public and a more knowledgeable public?
Absolutely. Like they say, you learn everything, something every day. So obviously, people are going to become more informed every day. But really, the people who need to be voting are the more informed public to ensure the best representation for our country.
I have a question just to clarify. What information did you get from the Washington Post when you referred to that in your speech? In the orange dress, sorry.
Yes, so an article from Robert Samuelson highlighted the tweaks in language. So between the liberal and conservative sides of the bipartisan.
Well, the Washington Post is a source of mass media, but you had previously mentioned that it is a biased source and is not improving the quality of Democratic decision making. So how are you able to support that it is helping your case today?
So the Washington Post is, yes, a newspaper, and it is, yes, published to the public, but it highlighted both sides of the argument. It showed both parties. Therefore, it is a reliable source.
The other thing to notice is that, for the negative, we are not saying that mass social media never can help us. The resolution here is, does it improve it? And when we think about improve, it means that all the advantages have to outweigh the negatives. So even though there might be a few benefits to it, there's still plenty more negatives to it that it outweighs it for sure.
Where do you suppose that people get information then if mass media is not a reliable source to improve democratic decision making? Do you expect people to maybe pay for a subscription to an online database that's peer reviewed and get all their information through that if it's much harder to get access to, as you put, real news? Then where should we go to get things that aren't biased?
Can you repeat the question?
Sorry about that. Where do you suppose people get information that is not biased beyond reason, like social and mass media usually has?
In essence, we are not trying to prove that there's going to be a different source in order to use this information to help democratic decision making. If you look specifically at the information you can find from social and mass media, it's specifically biased to the information that is there, and it's specific to the bias of the author who's going to write that information. So there are going to be other forms of information that we can get in order to help democratic decision making. It's just not mass and social media.
To extend that previous question, in your speeches, you claim that most forms of mass media are businesses pushing an agenda. Aren't there non-biased sources of information like NBR, Public Broadcasting Service, the British Broadcasting Corporation, that provide non-biased information?
There's still going to be a bias, though. Bias is innate in every single one of those mass media sources. No matter what it is, it is a business. It's going to produce ratings. It's going to produce profit. So there's going to be a bias in which way it can help the business itself more than informing the public.
All right, thank you to the question panel. We're going to move into the final part of the debate now, which is the rebuttals. In a rebuttal, of course, you're not supposed to make new arguments. You're not supposed to continue putting more arguments out there. Instead, the idea is to sum up what's already happened in the debate, to tell a coherent story as to why the audience should vote for you, all things considered. So to give the affirmative rebuttal will be Max Nowak.
Good morning. As we have all seen today, social and mass media do indeed improve the democratic decision-making of citizens in our democracy. The affirmative team has proposed a strong case that asserts the quality of democratic decision-making depends on a citizen's participation, as well as their access to information that they then make decisions in the democratic process. Therefore, this access to knowledge and information is making those decisions better. Democracy has always depended on the individual to make those decisions. Our case focuses on this reality of the individual autonomy. It is absolutely a matter of choice and public trust that democracy depends on. Thus, improvement at the decision-making process is based on more voices being heard, more representation, and increased, again, participation. We have shown time and again, because of the increased availability and widespread access to more knowledge, more information, this has produced more participation as well as greater voices heard. It has even led to a decrease in corruption. These are all benefits for democracy. Indeed, society has progressed beyond the simple bias of propaganda and cartoons and politicians that have always been innate to our democracy and our culture, to the point that those may exist on a new platform, but we at the same time have greater access to information. Therefore, a great crux of our argument that is greater than negatives is that yes, bias has always been present, always present in news media, it will be present in social and mass media, but that is a factor that has not changed. What has changed is our access to all that information, which is an absolute benefit that outweighs the negatives argument. Furthermore, I would like to address how the negative has been accusing that this bias is going to influence people. This does not hold sway to the individuality of voters because they are making, again, their own decisions based on the information that they see. And even if it is true, while the negative says that there are problems with how the news outlets are presenting things, it is also true that the news media and social media outlets have a responsibility to present topics such to an extent that it engages us, that it arouses action, and people understand that current events are happening, that they're important. We used the Women's March as a key example of this phenomenon, where news agencies and social mass media outlets were engaging people to participate in the democratic process, absolutely improving their abilities to make decisions. This attack on the news media, furthermore, is not a topical strategy. It is an attempt to use the boogeyman of the news media as an outweighing factor to this access, which is greater, and it is notwithstanding in the terms that we have outlaid for how democratic decision-making is improved. Thank you.
And now to give the final speech of the debate, in favor of the negative side will be Travis Seisman.
Good morning. I would like to begin by going over the fact that we do stand in negation of the fact that social and mass media does not improve the quality of democratic decision-making process. To begin, in the first specific affirmation, it was stated that a congressman that was in there was reading tweets that he looks for as he's making his decisions in court, or not in court, in his polls, of course. These people that he's looking at with the information may not be completely informed of the polls he's looking at. And it's also important to look at the fact that since it's Twitter, most of the people that will most likely be following this congressman are most likely following him due to the fact that they have the same viewpoints as him, which makes it more biased because he's looking at the same things that people already agree with him for. To influence and change the public's opinion, that is not the democratic decision-making progress, because in large groups as that, you are getting group decisions, not so much an individualistic decision, which is what we are looking for within a democratic process. It is also important to look at the fact that social and mass media take away social skills. In the first specific affirmation, it was stated that they do improve them, which was not true. It is known that using social mass media or technology in general end up hindering your social development skills because you do not have the face-to-face contact that you would need to further advance your social skills. It is also important to look at things where we were looking at them as a national level. When we look at other things from other countries, it's you can't see corruption. Like, if you were to check with people in a certain country, they would have to specifically tell you that a country is corrupt. A political official, however, wouldn't be the one to tell you that it was corrupt, so you wouldn't be getting the accurate information if that's how we were getting our information. It's also, we also need to look at how would you find, paper change. yes, there is, when we look at tweets, a lot of the social changes, that social media things that we're looking at were based on Twitter, and Twitter can only hold up to 140 characters, which isn't really giving you the whole story. When we look at tweets in general, like I said previously, you're only looking at a group decision rather than an individual, so you aren't really being accurately informed, and the citizens that are just following people that already share their same opinions aren't getting the whole story as they would by talking with each other instead of having the social media. One statistic that we have that backs that up is 60%, 2% of adults said that they get their information from Facebook, according to journalism.org. When we look at Facebook, a lot of those, it's not a news website, it's a social media. We are discussing things on Facebook that are just with each other, and if that's where people are getting their information and news from, we aren't exactly getting the whole truth. You're getting someone's opinion versus someone else's opinion. We can't be thankful for fake news, as it's not right. It's blatantly a lie or just misinformation in general. It is also important to acknowledge bias. We have to acknowledge it. It's not exactly helping us, and never has. We have been given facts from both the negative and the affirmative side, but the goal here was to prove that the affirmation needed to improve the quality of democratic decision making. And yes, we both provided facts on both sides, but based on the resolution, they need to specifically show that there was an increase in quality rather than just giving facts. Who's to weigh if there's more negative or positive on either side? You can't just give facts and say there was an increase in quality. If they were unable to prove that there was an increase in the quality, then they did not uphold the resolution. Therefore, it just doesn't stand. Thank you.
Now, audience, you have the opportunity to ask some questions of the debaters. Try to, if there's anything that you think still hasn't been resolved, if you need some more information to be able to cast your ballot, this is your chance to get that information from the debaters. So Lauren Giono will be coming around with a microphone, and if you would like to ask a question, raise your hand now.
Okay, if you want to say your name and then state your question.
Thank you. My name is Matthew Gallup, and I have a question for the affirmation specifically. Repeatedly in your arguments, you said that America was a democracy. However, are you aware that it is actually a constitutional republic and not a democracy? And within a democracy, a direct democracy, which is what you are implying, social media is about the quantity of voices and not the quality, whereas in a constitutional republic, it more reflects a quality of the voices over the quantity. So would not social media decrease what America was built upon and the Founding Fathers created?
Thank you for your question. The Constitutional Republic of the United States is a form of democracy, and using the resolution as we did talking about the United States, though it is not a direct democracy, it is absolutely more pertinent to this topic, to the debate, and to the general education that we discuss its reality in the United States. In the United States, of course, you are correct, we have a constitutional democracy, or republic. Again, a form of democracy that is absolutely still relevant to the topic at hand, and as you can also see, the negative was using mostly examples from the United States as well. So the argument was limited to the United States for the most part.
Okay.
Just another one, a few rows in front of you.
Yeah, just state your name and then your question.
My name is Tim Tierney. This is a question for the affirmation. I don't know if any of you know this, but the United States is only 5% of the world's population. So I was just wondering if there are any specific examples of any other international countries where democracy is improved by social mass media.
Thank you, Timmy, for your question. And to go off of that, I found from Media Development Investment Fund, a 2004 study that I said earlier persisted of 97 countries and covering that time period from 1995 to 2002. And it found that a press freedom, that you have less restrictions on the press, leads to a 5.1% improvement in the corruption perception index. So with having social mass media for all of the country, it helps corruption throughout the country, can help us as a country of the United States, but can also help and make the world a better place.
That was an excellent question, by the way. It always behooves you in a debate to question the breadth of applicability of the evidence. My name's Adam and I'm from Freeport. My question is directed at both of the sides. Bias was mentioned on both sides frequently, and it was also mentioned and agreed upon that bias is innate in any type of decision making in general. So I have to ask, is there any way to limit bias in conveying information through media, or is there a way to limit bias by not using media as a source of your information? Because like you said, bias does exist, but it probably shouldn't, no matter which side you stand on.
That's a great question. As you mentioned, bias is innate. And although there is a very limited way we can restrict it in terms of how Facebook has a fact-checking type of system, the main way we can bias it is just with our own personal thoughts, like what we choose to believe. If we believe something's biased, we have every single right to look more into it and get more information. So the best way to prevent bias is really just to look at it from a personal standpoint and determine, based on what you trust, what your decision should be.
So since that question was directed towards our side as well, we'll answer as well. So you asked, is there any way to limit the bias? And I really don't think there is. And that's kind of the point that we're trying to make, is there are those very reliable sources, like the question panel had mentioned. And it's a matter of the bias sources are the ones that we like to go to for our information, like the ones like Twitter and, of course, all the mainstream outlets that we have today. So it is very difficult to limit that bias in that stand.
I would like to quickly extend the affirmative's answer to that question also. Even in the case of our audience's interaction, we talked about how it is rather easy to identify fake news. There are categorizable tactics and tendencies that are easy to perceive and point out. And even as there was a counterexample of our sitting president, he is a singular phenomenon. And even we can say that he tends to say things that happen to be untrue. So extending the affirmative's answer to that question, everyone knows where fake news is and how to address it.
All right, so I'm Mackenzie DeVita from Kennerdale High School, and my question is to the affirmative. So you mentioned several times throughout your debate about bias and how it's evident in media, social media, everywhere. However, I want to know how you would account for confirmational bias in the case that most people wouldn't actively seek out information that disproves or disagrees with their own beliefs.
Can you repeat that question, please?
Yeah, so confirmational bias is the idea that a lot of people agree with things, that's why they follow certain accounts on Twitter or watch certain news stations. But confirmational bias is the idea that they don't actively seek out ideas or information that would go against those beliefs. So how would you account for that in your affirmation that bias exists in the media?
The affirmative would answer that in light of the historical evidence that this confirmational bias has absolutely always existed. There's no new feelings or human tendencies that is being directly produced by social and mass media. to make us more herd mentality or more oriented to confirmational bias. And if there was, the negative has not shown us that. But again, in light of historical evidence, this confirmational bias has always existed, and therefore it is not a nullification of our affirming the greater access and participation in the democratic process. Thank you.
Hi, I'm Hannah. I'm from Steel Valley. My question is to the negative side. One of your speakers had stated that the democratic decision-making has been obliterated. Is that because Hillary Clinton lost? Because that is how it was made to be said, I thought personally, but can I get your actual reasoning behind it? Thank you.
Can you say that last part one more time?
Sorry.
That's okay.
I was just saying that it seemed as if people around me also thought that you were stating that it was obliterated because Hillary Clinton had lost is maybe what we had gotten from it, or can I get your actual reasoning behind why you believe that the democratic decision-making process is obliterated?
I see what you mean there, and the idea there is when I said obliterated the democratic foundation our country was founded upon, it was not me choosing a side of that presidential election one bit. It was taking into consideration everything that we've talked about from this negative standpoint about mass and social media and how there's so many more negatives, specifically with the bias, specifically with the fake news. All of those points come together and show that this democratic foundation that we were built upon, that everyone gets their say and everyone is able to articulate the exact point that they want to, is essentially gone and essentially is taken away completely.
Hi, my name's Rachel. My question is for the negation. Wouldn't you say that it's the responsibility of the American citizen to be informed about the issues that they are willing to vote on? So in turn, wouldn't it be their responsibility to weed out the bias and then find the truth through their sources, such in social and mass media?
I'm sorry, really fast, can you repeat that again?
Oh, it's for the negation. Don't you think that it's the responsibility of the American public to be informed about issues in order to make decisions, and that goes into democratic decision making as a whole?
It's definitely the responsibility of the voter to be informed of what's going on. But with that said, if a news outlet, like they all do, have biased information, bias stems from one's opinion. So regardless of what news outlet they're reading from, the information that they gather, they will have a biased opinion from themselves that most likely they will still vote off of. And it's also the responsibility of the news anchor or the reporter or the company that's leaking out this information to make sure that it's accurate before they release it.
Hi, my name is Joey, whatever your last name is. And six corporations control 90% of the American media. And this is for the affirmative. How could you support that the businesses are not biased whenever they control 90% of that media?
The six super conglomerates that you are referring to do indeed own many news outlets, but at the same time, there are many local newspapers that are independent, and furthermore, many internet news providers, and the reality of social media, where everyone is a news provider of a sort, that are all democratizing that centralization of the news outlets, such that there's still a great diversity of perspective and thought, and we're not going to be sucked into some uniform worldview that limits us in our democratic decision-making process.
Also going along with that, with even though they do, there's large companies that own the news,
there are the solo reporters, and the solo reporters have to go under the code of ethics. And one main thing of news is to inform, and it's the reporter's job to find out the true information and report it. Whether they put their opinion in it or not, there is stated facts that have to follow under the code of ethics.
Hi, my name is Aaron, I'm from Steel Valley. So democratic decision making by its very nature means that majority of people, or more specifically the majority of voters, are the ones that make decisions in the country. Both sides now have said that it is up to the individual to make their own decisions. But being that democracy is a majority kind of voting, do you believe that the majority of Americans are smart enough to make the decisions that you're talking about?
Well, when we stated that it improves the quality of democratic decision making, you are completely valid by stating that it is about a majority. But when it comes down to it, when it comes to quality, it's more about whether the people who are making the said decisions are trusting themselves. So if they're smart enough, that can vary. But if they're at least confident enough to make the decision, that is how we truly know that the quality of decision making is improving.
I actually have a question for both teams. Would someone from each team comment on what you mean by improves? Because improves could mean that social and mass media improve decision making above and beyond how that decision making would occur in the absence of social and mass media, right? Comparing to the imaginary world where the media didn't exist. Or it could mean that recent technological developments have made their ability to do so better. In other words, does today's social and mass media improve, make democracy better than the social and mass media of 30 years ago? Which of these interpretations do you accept for each team? And you know, maybe you have some other interpretation.
Well, they're still talking there. I guess we'll answer for the negative. So when we hear this idea of improving, the first thing that comes to mind for me is making something more accurate, more defined. And in order to improve the quality of our decision making, that's making more responsible decisions for the behalf of our country. So I think that's what the negative team agrees when we hear that word improve.
We subscribe to the interpretation, as we stated in several of our general affirmative cases, that improvement is based upon more voices made and voices heard within the democratic body, more representation, furthermore participation of all of the democratic agents in our society. And so looking at especially social media, people are given a voice. The negative, in fact, conceded several times that there's widespread voices that will be heard by many other democratic people. And this increase in participation, this increase in voices heard, is absolutely a benefit to the democratic decision-making process, as everyone is coming together to participate in that process.
Right, but compared to what baseline? So is it an improvement upon the United States 30 years ago? Is it an improvement upon a world where there's no media whatsoever? Is it an improvement upon other countries?
Yes, 30 years ago, social media did not exist in its current form. The current form where you could use Twitter, Facebook, Reddit, what have you, is a significant step forward from a newspaper or seeing someone on the street and telling them what you think. The evolution of technology has absolutely added to the process, especially in social media.
And also going off of that, now with social media, if someone is stating something that is false or they think is not ethically right, someone will comment back and tell them, and basically correct the person if they are wrong. So we are holding each other accountable in that fact as well.
Thank you very much to all the audience members who had questions, and thank you to all of the debaters. We're going to be moving into the final part of this right now, where we're going to ask you to vote on our questions once again. So I'm going to turn it over to Gordon for the vote.
Bob, can we get the polls back up? Let's re-poll on, first of all, the audience question about social and mass media improve the quality of democratic decision making. You've seen this before. Final time we're going to ask you, and then we can measure to see if there's been any change. Have the speakers that you've heard from today shifted any audience opinion or not? I think we lost a school, so that is definitely fly in the ointment of our data. We'll have to take that into account, but it still will be interesting. Final call on this question. All right, so we now have 35% strongly agree. Wow, that is a huge surge. It was 8 and 13 at the midpoint, now 35, then 24% holding steady, 6, a drop there in somewhat, 4, big drop in neutral, 5, somewhat agree, a drop in there, 10%, a little bit of a drop there, and then 17, strongly disagree growth there. So definitely a marked shift, I would say. Eric, how do you interpret these?
So you see a large shift toward the affirmative side of the resolution. You also see a shift toward strongly disagree as well. So when you ask the question pre-debate, that number is at 13%. It goes down to 10%. Mid-debate, and then goes up to 17% at the end of the debate. And so what you see is the audience becoming a bit more polarized as they make up their mind and move away from neutral, move away from somewhat agree or disagree toward the edges. And so neutral went from 13% up to 20% mid-debate, and then all the way down to 4% at the end of the debate. And I think that this actually bodes well. It means that you went into the debate with an open mind, you were challenging your own opinions throughout the debate, but in the end, you made a decision. You sort of came to one side of the debate or the other. So that being said, there is definitely a bigger shift toward strongly agree than there is toward strongly disagree. The strongly agree number goes up from 8% before the debate to 13% mid-debate, all the way up to 35% at the end of the debate. So both teams did a good job of getting people to get off of the fence, right? Get them to come over to their side, although it looks like the affirmative team did a little bit better.
Okay, final poll then is Merritt on the other side. Again, we re-polled twice before. Let's open the polls. Final call here. And let Eric interpret. And then wrap it up and take a break.
All right, so this is the question of whether you thought the side that you disagree with has merit. On the strongly agree number, that number went up quite a bit. Pre-debate, you were at 18%, mid-debate at 19%, by the end of the debate, all the way up to 29%. And so those of you who thought that the side you disagree with had a lot of merit went up, and that's good. That means that you were sort of persuaded by both sides in the debate. The side that you agree with just happened to persuade you more, but you have more respect for the other side as well. So that's the sign of a very successful debate, and I think that reflects very good arguments made by both teams in this debate. The agree number went down slightly. It went down from 35 to 32 down to 26%. That's largely people moving into the strongly agree category. Now, you do have a big jump at the end, though, when it comes to strongly disagree. That went from 4% before the debate to 7% mid-debate all the way up to 15% at the end of the debate. So this could largely be attributed to you sort of coming to a decision as the debate went along, becoming more and more sure about your own position and following the team that supported your position in the debate. And so as you make up your mind, as you become persuaded by the team you thought won the debate, relatively speaking, the other side has less merit to it. Right? So there is some question here as to whether we mean relative to the other side, does the side you disagree with have merit, or are we talking about this question in absolute terms? That is all I have to say about the polling. I wanted to turn it over for a moment to the question and answer panel. I know that you had some thoughts you wanted to share at the end of the debate as well. If not, that's okay.
No.
I was somewhat surprised that the negative didn't really attack specifically the idea of individualism and the weight of research being on the individual and not being on the people that are giving out the information. When this pit debate went over in my classes, that was often a contested point, was the individual versus collectivist, the idea of, whether or not the burden was on the companies giving the information or the individual getting the information. I was surprised that that didn't get flushed out more in this debate.
Ah, yes.
The ethical question of responsibility.
Although this resolution, I would argue, and as we saw in the debate today, lends itself to politics, I was interested to see if either side brought up other aspects to democratic decision-making. It extends to more than just politics, I think. And it was mentioned, but I think that that's something that could have been taken further. And there could have been more arguments on, other than politics, how else does social and mass media influence other forms of democratic decision-making?
I believe both sides were very knowledgeable about the viewpoints that they were assigned. However, I do wish they would have denounced each other's viewpoints more, like more or less gone and said why the opposing side's contentions were either incorrect or not as valid as their points were. So I was more or less looking for something like that.
One question that I wanted to ask, but since it was kind of not brought up in the debate, I refrained, and that's the impact of foreign nations on democratic elections. I think not only in the presidential election of 2016 for the United States, but also upcoming elections throughout Europe, how, I guess in this specific example, a country like Russia can use conventional forms of social media as well as fake news and mass media to influence the way voters vote in foreign countries. So that would have been an interesting view to bring up and see how that our democratic process could be corrupted, not from the inside, but rather from the outside.
Good. Thank you for those insights. I'd like to congratulate all the debaters for doing an excellent job today. And it looks like the affirmative team won by a slight margin, but both teams did a good job of persuading audiences and moving them away from the neutral and somewhat agree and disagree positions and into the agree and strongly positions. Before we go, do any of the teachers have any announcements? Gordon?
No, okay, so let's actually not spend that much time, maybe 2 or 3 minutes to stretch your legs, and then we'll close with the final ceremony. Thank you.
Hey, great job.
Thank you, you too.
Thank you.
Yeah, are we leaving?
All right, folks, we're going to wrap up here briefly by giving out some awards. We heard some fantastic speeches, both in the SPAR Championship of the Known Universe and also the formal demonstration debate here, the College and High School Argument Forum. Eric is coming around to collect audience response system clickers, so if you could help him out by giving your clickers and putting them in that box, that would be great. Audience did a nice job with the clicker voting, produced some very interesting data, including some data that might be useful to schools and the CHS program, which we'll mull over later on. So first of all, let me recognize four speakers, actually, who were outstanding in the SPAR Championship of the Known Universe. First, honorable mention for debating colleges should not require SATs, Kirsten Maxwell from Pine Richland. Come on up. Is Kirsten still here? Do we have an award? Okay, we'll get that to her. Third place, who Joey didn't actually prevail, but he did score very high, 43% in audience response. Joey Kalemon from Ambridge, nice work. Third place in the SPAR Championship. Winning some college and high school swag. Here he comes. Second place with two victories, Julie Siepel from Freeport. Come on up. Excellent work, Julie. Great debating. Nice job. And the winner with three wins, he won three consecutive SPAR rounds. From Steel Valley, Aaron Kornacki. Aaron, come on up and retrieve some college and high school swag. Very nice. And now, let's give some prizes to each of the students that were selected for the College and High School Argument Forum that you just heard from. First of all, from Ambridge, Lauren Guyana. Come on over.
Thank you.
Belle Vernon, Jillian Curta. Yeah. Some excellent questions from her. Belle Winantis, Grace Mazzara. Blackhawk Mitchell Paleo. Central Catholic Max Nowalk, they just had to leave to get back to an assembly, so we'll have to give that to him later. Fort Cherry Emily Richard. Freeport TJ Piscucci. Kennard Dale, Travis Seisman. North Allegheny, Brendan Jibb. North Hills, Dom Melchior. Oakland Catholic, Carolyn Sioko. Pine Richland, Alexa Chavara. Quaker Valley, Michael Parker. Seneca Valley, Isabella Seaman. Steel Valley, Tamaya Robinson. Thank you, Eric, very much for your moderating. Thank you, college and high school staff, for all the wonderful work that you do. We're grateful again to North Allegheny for allowing to host us. And good work, teachers and students. Keep it up. We'll see you next year. Thank you very much.